it's our time to move towards the actual session, which will be conducted by Dr. Akhtar Parvez. Let me introduce you, Akhtar Parvez. Actually, there is no need to introduce Akhtar Parvez,
You can skip.
sir. He is currently a university librarian at MANU, Maulana Azad Urdu University, you all know. And prior to that, he worked at IIM Indore as a librarian. He has completed his BCom from University of Delhi, then MLIS from Jamia Millia Islamia. He has about 27 years of vast administrative experience as far as knowledge in resource centers are concerned. And apart from MANU and IIM Indore, he also worked with Delnet, then India International Center, USIS, and the National Council of Applied Economic Research. He has contributed more than 17 papers, as well as edited 8 conference volumes and authored one book. He is the managing editor of Journal of Library Management and on the editorial board of Gyankosh. Akhtar has received so many awards, and the most crucial and important awards are AIIMS International Irma for Outstanding Management Librarian Award in 2016, SRFLIS India Library Leaders Promising Professional Award in 2013. He got ILA Promoter Award in 2002 and Best Young Librarian Award in 2015 for Indore Division Library Association. He also got Vishwalakshmi Best Librarian Award by Inmatec Institutions in 2016. And after that, I think he shifted towards the award giving category. So, being an active founder member of Manlibnet, Akhtar is contributing in various professional activities. And he also elected as a general secretary of Manlibnet for consistently 2 consecutive terms. He is known for his assertive behavior, very empathetic attitude, and cooperative nature. With these words, I heartily welcome Dr. Akhtar. Over to you for the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Minal, and I am very grateful that you all, Mukta and IMCC, decided to call me as one of these speakers. And when you call a librarian, I mean, when teachers call a librarian to speak, so then it's always very, very challenging. So my good morning to all the participants who are there, all the dignitaries who have logged in, and I hope I'll be able to convey what I want. So let me just share my screen with you. I'll be speaking, as Meenal said, on record retention policy for academic libraries. You can see my screen. Just a second, just let me disable my meeting. Okay, so as I said, I'll be speaking on records retention policy for academic libraries. And before I tell you about my topic, let me briefly tell you about my university. You see, our university was established in 1998. We have a few colleges of teachers' education. We have few polytechnics. We have satellite campuses in 13 different cities of India. All kinds of courses are taught in our university, and we have 3 schools. And ours is probably one of the very few universities which imparts education from KG to PhD. And the mandate of our university is to focus on girl education. So as the Honorable Secretary, Dr. Bharat said, we have to reach out to our students. Now, there is an old saying, if Muhammad does not go to the mountain will come to Muhammad. So what does it mean basically, see, if you take the context of LIS? It means that, you know, if users are not able to come to the library, we have to reach out to the students. And which was very rightly advised by Dr. Bharat also. But, you know, for reaching out to the students, we have to make sure that, you see, we are able to provide good service and the kind of service which does not really waste time of our users, students, faculty, etc. But for developing, you know, good services, obviously we have to develop good processes, because if we don't develop processes, probably we'll not be able to cater to our users more efficiently. And if we develop processes, we will save a lot of time of our users. So what I did, you know, during last few years, I developed few processes with the help of my colleagues in these areas, that is acquisition, stock verification, record retention. You know, in acquisition and stock verification, we came out with some very innovative ways of doing the processes relating to receiving our books, and instead of directly entering books into Koha, we were entering in Google Sheet. And also for the stock certification, we came out with a very innovative process. And I made a video which is there on my YouTube channel. So if you get time, please watch it and give me your honest feedback. And then, of course, the record retention policy. So record retention policy, let me just first give you the definition of record or information. I prefer taking the definition from the RTI Act, that is the Right to Information Act 2005, where information means documents, memos, emails, opinions, advices, press releases, circulars, orders, logbooks, contracts, reports, papers, samples, models, data material, etc. So anything which is in material form will make part of a record or information as per the RTI Act 2005. And, you know, I mean, records management, of course, is an essential function of any organization, whether it's a small organization, big organization, or a medium-sized organization. And for performing your, you know, day-to-day functions, you have to refer to the previous records. Like, for example, in libraries, if you take, for example, you find that if you want to check duplicates, you will have to really see your earlier records, I mean, the catalog. So there are multiple examples wherein you will have to refer to the old records. And, you know, the volume of records in any organization will depend on the age of the institution. So older the institution, larger will be the records. And as records increase, space keeps shrinking, right? So there was a report which I read yesterday. It was a 2018 report of Environmental Paper Network, which gives some very interesting statistics about paper. So why I'm talking of paper statistics, because I'm talking of records, and paper form a large volume of records. So it says that paper consumption is at unsustainable levels, and globally it is steadily increasing, particularly in Asia. It also says that the consumption of paper, see, has exceeded 400 million tons per year. And if you see this graph, which I took from this report, it's a 2014 statistics, where Asia is second, you see, in terms of paper consumption. Now, similarly, if you go to Statista website, you will get some very interesting statistics where you see, if you see the consumption, you see, this is 2017 data. So if you see the consumption, then we are the fifth largest user of paper. And printing and writing paper form substantial part of paper industry. And here the demand is quite high. You see, this is about India. Now, similarly, if you see the number of emails exchanged during 2017 to 2023. This 23 is basically, there are 4 years which they have taken as forecast. So they forecast that by 2023, the total volume of emails which have been sent and received is more than 350 billion. So you can understand the kind of, you know, records which is increasing every day. And in our libraries also, we see a lot of records, a lot of old files lying in our storeroom or various other places. But we hardly, you know, think that these records need to be discarded. And the one important reason why we are hesitant about discarding these records is because of various laws that we have in our country. There are, like, for example, there is a Record Safety Act and, of course, RTI Act. So because of these, you know, we have to ensure that there are, the records are kept for more number of years or for a certain number of years. Now, most libraries I have seen are in the habit of keeping documents forever, and they hesitate taking any decision about discarding them. And some of the libraries have large number of files and documents which occupy a substantial or significant space of any library. We do weed out books quite regularly, but unfortunately, we do not weed out these records that we have, the administrative records, I should say. And, you know, the mindset is that we may require it at some point of time. And that is the reason we do not discard the records. So if you go to your librarian, or if I go to my vice chancellor, if I tell him I am planning to discard records, the first thing he will tell me, you know, if you require these documents in the future, what you will do. So this is the mindset that we have. And that is one reason why we are always hesitant in discarding records. So keeping records indefinitely may even consume more time of the workforce in locating required documents. So of course, you see, if you have more records, your staff will take more time to locate those documents. And unless you have a great deal of space and a great deal of money, you can delay the process of discarding, but you actually cannot avoid it. Okay, so one day you will have to discard some of the records. And in such a scenario where records are created every minute, the organizations have to get rid of some documents which are of ephemeral nature, or retain, protect those which are required to be maintained or preserved for longer duration. So documents which are not required for longer duration, you can always think of discarding those documents. But, you know, destruction of records without having a written order or policy may lead to confusion and certain legal implications. And I was referring to Public Records Act, which says that, you see, if you destroy records, then it will amount to breach of Public Records Act 1993 and is punishable with imprisonment up to a term of 5 years or with fine or both. So it is important that we have a records retention schedule. So what is records retention schedule? This is a schedule which clearly states that these particular records should be discarded after these many years, then another set of records should be discarded after these many years, and there will be some records which you will have to keep permanently with you. Like, for example, accession register. So accession register, you will always have to keep permanently with you. So why we need really such policy? I mean, it is very simple to say that, you see, it is useful for organization having large volume of files, papers, and the organization which want to dispose some of the records. The bigger the organization, as I already said, the more helpful the policy will be for such organizations. Having a formal schedule for retaining, discarding of documents will reduce dependence on the memory of employee in managing records. You know, we always see in our libraries that there will be one or two persons, some senior guys, you know, who will find out document for you based on their memory. But, you know, it is important that we don't rely on their memory, or we don't depend on their memory. It is good that, you see, they have good memory. But, you know, we should not make it a practice to depend on their memory for searching of records. And that is probably one reason, you see, why we have library catalog, etc., etc. And The written policy or retention schedule will help the staff in taking an informed decision in the retention or disposal of records, right? And more space for records will attract more cost to organization. Now, you know, gone are the days when government used to give us more space for, you know, for universities, for institutions. Now, if you see newer institutions, so instead of creating or constructing bungalows, you know, they are creating buildings, see, which can house more people, I mean, with multiple floors. So it is important that, you see, we have to keep into account that the cost which is involved in occupying large space in any organization. So sooner or later, it becomes essential to have a written document guiding organizations about the record retention schedules. Hence, you know, we have to have a policy, you know, which tells us that you can destroy records on a regular interval. Or in other words, one may safely destroy records as per the policy without getting into any kind of trouble in the future, either under the Public Records Act 1993 and of RTI Act of 2005. Let me just briefly tell you about this RTI Act. You know, in 2014, what happened that there was a public information officer who was supposed to give information to public. He could not give information to the person who sought this information, and he simply said that the records have been destroyed. And then that person went to the Central Information Commission and complained. And then there was a hearing in 2014 where Mr. Sridhar said that unless proved that record was destroyed as per the prescribed rules of destruction or retention policy, it is deemed that record continues to be held by the public authority. I mean, public authority means any government organization like ours or yours. And that public information officer was imposed a penalty of ₹25,000 for not providing the record. Obviously, there is a possibility that he did not have that record and might have destroyed it. Similarly, there was another report which where, see, this commissioner said that the public authority cannot deny the right of the appellant by putting forward an excuse of the missing file. So if any file is missing, you have to create some document in your library, or if the document, if the file or document is sensitive, you must lodge an FIR saying that documents have been stolen or got missing. In another similar case in 2016, the public information officer informed the commission that some of the old records have been damaged and eaten by termite. And the commissioner said that destruction of records by termite action is not a defense under the RTI Act and imposed a penalty of ₹25,000 on the PIO for not providing the records. But, you know, had that organization, I mean, following a policy of destroying records in a timely manner, probably the situation of ₹25,000 penalty would not have come. And this penalty on public information officer is paid from their own personal money. It's not that the organization pays for it. And if any document is required from your library, then you become the deemed PIO, which means that if you are not able to provide document to the public information officer of your institution, then this penalty will be on you, not to the PIO, because you are the holder of those records which are sought under RTI Act. So, you know, we kept thinking what to do. And then we, while I was working with IIM Indore, so then we checked with some of the premier institutions of the country. We wanted to know if they have a policy. But unfortunately, you know, we came to know that there are certain institutions who have large amount of records, old records, and a large space is being occupied for keeping those records, and they are not destroying the records. Or you can say they did not have any record retention policy. And then, see, we thought, let us see if there is any document available on the Government of India website. And then we found a document which was of 2012 by the Department of Administrative Reforms and Public Grievances. And this record was this document was basically on a record retention schedule. It says record retention schedule in respect of records common to all ministries and departments. So because universities or academic institutions come under MHRD, so Department of Higher Education, so every university or IIMs and IITs are also covered under that. Now, if you see here, you know, this is the table of content where I found that there is a section on library on page number 43, which talks about library documents. And this classification was as per the Central Secretariat Manual of Office Procedure. So this was the chart which was given in this government document. So if you see here, you know, the main heading says library, then ordering and receipt of books other than government publications, then it says ordering and receipt of periodicals, purchase of documents, and it says C3. C3 means for 3 years you have to keep documents of this particular nature. And then, you know, for lending, transfer, you know, you have to keep for 1 year, and some documents you have to keep for 3 years. Then binding of books, you have to keep for 3 years record. So I don't know why, you see, it says 3 years. Then selection committee for books, again, it says 1 year, et cetera, et cetera. And it also tells you that you have to keep the record of writing of books permanently with you. An auction of newspapers, membership, library association, et cetera, et cetera. So this we found on the government document. And then we thought, you know, we should start developing a policy for IIM Indore library. So these were some of the important points which I thought I must share with you, that you should always keep in mind when you design a policy or record retention schedule for your institution or say for your library. So destruction of records, as all you know, is very difficult. It is very complex. You see, you have to take very informed decision when you destroy a record. So accordingly, you have to design your policy. Organizations which have sub-organization, like for example, my university, we have 13 satellite campuses. All the campuses have libraries. So if I design a policy here for my university, it is going to be a little complex compared to an institution or a library which does not have any departmental libraries or satellite campuses libraries, etc., etc. So another important thing which we must keep into account is that there should be complete compliance with the prevailing law or relevant act. And while preparing a policy, it's very, very important that we have detailed list of documents, because unless we have a detailed list of documents, we probably will not be able to make a policy for our library. Say, for example, if you have acquisition section, so what are the files in acquisition section you may be having? Similarly, for circulation, what could be the important subsets of that circulation file, like collection of fine, renewal? I mean, there are a lot of things. So you have to have complete list of documents that exist in your library. And for there should be a proper justification for each retention period. Say, for example, if you say that I'll keep this record only for 1 year, then you have to give justification for that. Or if you are not putting it on record, then if somebody asks, you see, you should have a justification for why you are keeping particular record for 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, etc., or permanently. And, you know, my documents in the library may differ from your documents which you have in the library. So necessary customization can be done. But the major thing which one has to remember is that we have to follow the major guidelines which have been given in the ministry document, which I just showed you. And creating or naming or coding of new or existing files is a very important job. And you must identify a good person in the library who can do it, or if you want, you yourself can do it. And you have to take utmost care, you see, when you destroy any documents. You have to make sure that the records are not destroyed prematurely. And in my opinion, you know, though the government record says that some documents can be destroyed after 1 year or discarded after 1 year. But I always feel that there is no harm in keeping documents at least for 3 years so that there is no problem at all in the future. And then you also have to define the role and responsibility for records management and ownership of those documents. I mean, say if it is subscription, then who will be the owner of that file? If it is circulation, who will be the owner of those files? I think those things have to come in the written form, maybe in an Excel sheet or doc file or wherever you feel is the right medium. And then, you know, the policy needs to be periodically reviewed. There's a possibility that after 3 years, some documents may increase or add. So accordingly, you have to review it. So in my view, there's no harm in reviewing policy after every 3 years or so. And how the administration has to be done of this record retention policy, I feel that standard nomenclature in naming the files is very, very important. So it should not happen that at one place we see acquisition of books and on the other place we see, say, book acquisition. So there has to be some standardization. And as you all know, libraries run on principles of standardization. So standardization is very, very important. And I already told you about the ownership of file, and location is also very important. You know, you have to mention where is the location of that file. See, in large institutions or large libraries, what happens that location of the files are different places. So, of course, the librarian has to ensure that the proper policy compliance is there. And before, you know, implementing this policy, make sure that you have taken necessary approval from the competent authority or competent body. Say, for example, if it is university, then first of all, you see, if I have to design a policy for Molana Azad National University, what I will do, I will form a subcommittee, and then that subcommittee will give a report, and then that report will go to the library committee. Library committee will approve it, and then it will be approved by the academic council and finally the executive council, so that there is no problem in future for you. Now, at IIM Indore, you know, depending on the kinds of documents, we made this kind of retention schedule. So I separated acquisition, all the subheads of acquisition, then technical section, what all documents are there. And on the right hand side, you see, I have given the when you should discard, okay? 3 years, 5 years, you have to keep permanently. Then, you know, there are stock verification report and paper related to writing off. I have given here permanent. And there are then journal administration. Say, for example, your communication with departments, deans, your communication with vice chancellor, registrar, etc. If you see you run social media records, you have to keep records about social media. And then, you know, I mean, all kinds of records you'll have to keep. You may have more records, you have less records. So accordingly, you have to design a policy. So designing of a record retention policy is very, very important for all our libraries. If you want, I can, you know, send this PowerPoint presentation to you. And also, you know, I wrote an article on this particular thing, which was published in this Delhi Library Association journal. So that also I can share with you. So what is important is that, just a second. So what is important that, you know, is instead of searching for any document endlessly, it is better that we have a policy and we keep destroying records from time to time. That is very, very important. And if you use technology, you know, I always say that use of technology is very, very important. So if you use technology for doing all these things, it'll bring a lot of accuracy in whatever task you perform. It'll avoid duplication of efforts on the part of library staff. And you can, you know, improve the policy or anything. See, there can be incremental improvement in whatever you do in your libraries. And with regard to the templates that we prepared at IIM Indore for record retention schedule, that is just a one-time job. So if you have done it once, then it will always be relevant for you. Of course, you'll have to review and make changes. So while concluding, just let me tell you that the libraries world over follow best practices managing their records concerning acquisition, classification, etc. But unfortunately, you know, we do not do it when it comes to the administrative records like files, etc. And, you know, an established and well-administered record retention policy will lead to a uniform retention guidelines within libraries and may provide confidence to such institutions that records are preserved long enough to meet minimum legal requirement and documents which are of ephemeral nature are weeded out in time-bound manner. So not just weeding out of books, weeding out of other administrative records that we have in our libraries, which occupy a lot of space, also need to be weeded out, or you can say discarded or destroyed. And you will be very happy to know that when we did it at IIM Indore, we had about 1,000 files, and we found that 800 files were not of any use to us. So we discarded 800 files. So you can imagine the kind of space which we might have saved there in our library. So it's important, you know, that we must work very intelligently. And in every almost presentation, I say that good libraries are process driven and bad libraries are librarian driven. But here I'm not undermining the role of librarian. Of course, the role of librarian will always remain important. But we need to understand how, you know, intelligently we can work in framing policies, in developing processes. And developing processes is very, very, very important. I always stress that unless you develop process, you cannot make your staff efficient, okay? You have to train them in such a way that they also understand the importance of such manuals, policies, etc. So these were some of the references which I used. So thank you very much. I know now you cannot afford to stay home for very long. So stay safe. And I feel that when you go out, you should always assume that the other person is infected. Only then you can save yourself. Otherwise, it is very difficult. You know, I have seen whenever I go to the market, I have to make sure that, you know, I am little away from others. So unless you have that feeling that others is infected, but that does not mean that you have to start, maintaining social distancing. I do not like this word social distancing. I like the word physical distancing, because social distancing may lead to untouchability, which is not good. So with this, thank you very much. And I hope the presentation was of some use. So whatever documents are needed, I will be very happy to share with the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akhtar. It was very well presented. And what I liked the most was the last picture. That is the smart work and the hard work. I think earlier at our childhood, we used to listen the story about the crow only.
Yes.
That how crow used to drink water when it is at the bottom of the, you know, pot. But now in the world of technology, one should do how to do work smartly. And it has been effected very nicely through this picture. And I think every librarian should understand, or rather teaching community should understand, that nowadays in such kind of pandemics, how to work smartly. And I think that has been given rightly by you. Also, in your presentation, a lot of weightage has been given how records have to be maintained, what is the duration of maintaining the records, and what is the RTI Act. I think that is very much important from the librarian's point of view, because a lot of the professionals, they are not aware of these acts and rules and regulations and what to maintain, what not to maintain. I think some clarity has come. Those who are watching this particular webinar, I think they'll be aware. And your PPTs are really good, giving the government document and actual record maintenance, that what is the duration one should maintain. I think that is very useful. We have received certain questions.
Something I want to ask.
Yeah.
Shall I, Subhash sir?
Yes. Go ahead.
Thank you, Akhtar sir. What a fantastic presentation and much more information you have delivered. One thing I want to ask, whether it is a library audit, not only the financial term, as far as I'm belongs to the college, so I always see that the library inclusion in the audit in the financial point of view, that is a purchase and all that things. Is it rules are there where the retention point of view accession transaction point of view that audit is there, rules and regulation?
Madam, one is that there's Government of India documents or your policy can always take out the important points from there. The major guidelines could be those. Number two, when you develop a policy, as I said, you need to get it approved by the competent bodies. And once you get approved by the competent authorities, auditors will not be able to say anything. Okay, because that is a policy decision which has been taken by your university or college in the highest body. So once there is a policy, approved policy, then auditors, even if they raise any objection, and auditors are used to raise objection, I think it is you, the librarian, who need to defend yourself. And I have seen some very absurd queries from auditors. And it is because that they do not have proper knowledge of the libraries. That is the biggest problem. So I tell my staff, don't make them so knowledgeable about these auditors. Let them be ignorant about libraries' work. But at the same time, your response should be such that the auditor is not able to point fingers on you. So I think, I think we have another session after that where, I will be for a couple of minutes, I'll be speaking on communication. So that communication is very important, how you actually, what kind of justification or argument you put forth to defend your case. So that is very important. And I always, I was thinking that I had received during my career of last 30 years. So I have received a large number of auditors' queries, which we answered. So I was thinking maybe, there should be one presentation where we just discuss auditors' queries in the context of libraries. So I think if you have a written policy, approved policy, they will not be able to raise any point.
It means each institution has to frame the independent policy for this, is it?
Yeah, I mean, yes. You see, either you adopt the same policy which Government of India, but that needs to be adopted. That needs to be adopted by the competent body, whether it is Academic Council or whatever. But it is better that on those lines, because all documents have not been included in the government policy, probably because one is, of course, that is an old document. So you can always improve upon that and add more documents in that.
Thank you.
Just to add up, Suvarna madam, I'll tell you that if at all UGC comes out with any of the directives, then they are not accepted directly into the university. They go to different councils, Academic Council, Management Council, and then they are passed and they are accepted by that university area. So it is similarly, like what are the rules and regulations are there for the libraries and we are going to accept, then same has to be taken to the library committee. And then it has to be sent to the principal, and through principal it should go to management for final approval.
Absolutely.
And once that is done, then we can follow that process forever. And even if there is an query from auditor, we can show that as a document that it has been resolved by our management. Is it accurate,
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
No, in the so many years I'm handling the library committee as a chairman, even the committee members don't know the what sort of things are into only purchase and fulfill the requirement of the teachers and the students every year's purchase and all that things. The committees are working for that only. They they are not thinking about this. I have taken one major decision of the discard, as Professor Akkar said, that discarding the old documents which was occupying the huge space of the library. There also the records, all the writing records, and this we are discarding, and this we are keeping. But there is no as such policy is there, as far as the colleges are concerned. And even the committee members, they don't know. As a chairman also, I was not aware. With this after sir's presentation, I got that there are certain norms are there as far as the retentions are concerned. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam, we librarians are there at your disposal. You can ask at any time, madam. Okay. Now, coming to the...
Now henceforth will be.
Yes. Now, Akhtar sir, coming to the questions very quickly, Mr. Vijay Kumar is asking, is there any time period for retention of the records in the office? I think you have made a mention, but if you would like to highlight anything apart from what your presentation had mentioned, please, Akhtar sir.
Yeah, I mean, if you see the government document, which is that Department of Administrative Reforms, see, the retention schedule is given there. And what I suggested in my presentation was that though in some of the documents, the policy, the government document says that you can keep it for 1 year. After the audit, you can destroy it. But I feel maybe, you know, instead of 1 year, let us keep everything for 3 years.
That's right. No harm in doing that. Some, yeah.
So let us be on the safer side. So as I said, if Mr. Vijay Kumar wants, I can share both the documents. I mean, the documents also, and also my article, which I had published, which tells you about the government norm of keeping the record and what we have prepared. And as I said, I am not saying that you have to follow that as it is. Obviously, you may be having different records. Your requirement will be maybe different. But again, you know, I stress that it's important that the major guidelines are followed or taken from the ministry documents, so that we can always justify why we are doing it. Justification is important.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Maybe, sir, we will also upload it on our website once you send it to us.
I will.
So that it will be useful for all of them.
I will.
One question from Pradnya Ghonge. Reading of books can be done after how much time? And is there any specific guidelines? If yes, please explain.
You know, there are no... you see, every library has its own guidelines. So if you don't have, you can prepare one. Now, why you weed out books? The reasons are, say, for example, if we have second edition of a book, okay, and we have received third edition or fourth edition of a book, obviously, you know, you need to weed out the older edition. Why? Because if students read from second edition, there's a possibility that they will not get updated information. So it is better to weed out those books. You also weed out those books which are lost and which you are not able to replace. Okay. You also weed out those books which are damaged. Okay. So, I mean, what you can do is that depending on the requirement of your library, of course, following the major principles of LIS, you can have a written document on that too. That in 3 years, you will review your collection. In 5 years, you will review your collection for weeding out. Weeding out is very important. Like, say, for example, if I talk of my library, we had 1.5 lakh document, and then we found that we don't have a space for adding the new editions. So what we did, we weeded out about, I think, 2,000 books or so. All the old editions, books which... were completely damaged. So those things we had to, do in our life. So you have to prepare your own set of rules for weeding out. But yes, you see, when you are preparing, I can always help you. I can, we can add something from whatever I have. So that we can.
Sir, I think that association level also, if we could come out with such documents,
I think that is a good idea.
Yeah, the standard operating procedures, SOPs, which will really help to the librarians at large, isn't it?
So I think that would be fantastic if we can do that. But unfortunately, we don't pay attention to such things. We just do conferences, webinars. And the real need of the librarians, and especially those librarians who are working in interiors, okay, they do not have exposure, they struggle every day, their management does not support them, and unfortunately, we as associations, we are also not able to do much, but at least academically, we can, you know, help them. So that is important. If Dr. Surikumar is, I think, is also here in the presentation, so Dr. Surikumar, I think we should do this.
Yes, I think we have August presence of Dr. Dahibate, Dr. Patil sir, and with their help, because they have tremendous knowledge about all this because of their vast experience.
Yes.
And I think if we could make use of that and prepare such documents, I think that would be a landmark document and which will be helpful for all the librarians at large. Sir, one question is there from Sheetal D. If we want to discard journals and magazines, what is the procedure? Can you please explain?
Journals and magazines. You know, magazines, of course,
there
could be some magazine which may be of ephemeral nature, right? Like, for example, India Today, Frontline. Those things, I mean, there is no problem. But the other scholarly journals, I feel that you should not discard. What best you can do is keep an electronic copy. If you find that those records are getting damaged, you can keep an electronic copy. And the Copyright Act, there was an amendment in 2012 which allows us to keep an electronic copy of every material that we have in the library, provided, I mean, though the act is silent, but we should make sure that we do not violate the copyright rules. So for the use of such journals in the university, that we can always digitize and put it on our library server so that people can see. I suggest that journals you should not, because journals are things which may be required after 50 years also.
Scholarly. Can I ask one question?
Sure, sir.
One thing I want to add to this,
yes,
for journals, core journals should be retained as it is. You cannot touch to the core journals, but peripheral journals, which are obsolete after some time, because some projects are over, some work is over, and it is of not use, that can be weeded out very safely. But what Akhtar is telling us, you have a policy with clear mentioning what is that retention period and how to weed it out. So that much I want to add.
Can I ask one question after, sir?
Sure, sir.
Yeah. Sir, I just wanted to know, is there any certificate of destruction required to show that we are not in possession of those documents?
You know, whenever you destroy any document, okay, you make a list of those documents and get it approved
from the competent authority.
Competent authority. Because otherwise, you will not be able to prove, I mean, which documents you destroyed and with whose approval.
That is normal practice followed.
Yes. That is the normal office procedure.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think, sir, Dr. Akhtar, you have made so many things so clear, crystal clear. And definitely, they'll be really helpful to all our library professionals and to the society at large. There are several compliments to you in the chat box that your presentation especially was fantastic and your way simplicity is very good. Some of them have asked about your PPTs also.
Sure.
And of course, yes, always what we see is also they are asking about the feedback link immediately after the session. Okay. So for those who are asking for the feedback link, let me tell them that you will get the feedback link. Today we are sending two feedback links, one for today's session and one for the entire weekend program which we have organized for you all. So there'll be two links which will be posted on our website, which for which the link is already there with you. After the completion of the session, those links will be made active, and you all can submit your feedback into that particular with that particular link. I take this opportunity to thank you, Akhtar sir, for enlightening us and giving us this opportunity to listen to you, and you know, with a wonderful presentation, with uplighting of the RTI Act, and what to be preserved, what not to be preserved, what is the time duration, and all such small queries which every professional does have. And really, I am grateful to you from the entire Mukta team and from